Welcome to the week 9 of ITE 1712 web design course. In this week, we are going to learn JavaScript programming concepts. As usual, we will be following the same color coding pattern we have been using from the beginning of this course. So what will you learn after this week's learning? You will be able to apply programming structures into JavaScript programs. After this lesson, you will be able to write programs with if conditional statements and write programs with switch selection statements, functions, and how to pass parameters into these functions. And finally, how to write JavaScript with inputs. For an example, pop-ups. So when you write JavaScript programs, depending on the value of a variable, we might want to do different things. So in JavaScript, we have following types of conditional statements. First, we have this if statement. When we want to specify a block of code to be executed, if a specified condition is true, what if we want to do something if that particular case is not true? Then we use the else statement along with the if statement to execute that code. Whenever we want to check new condition, if the previous condition is failed, then we use else if condition or else if statement. What if we want to execute many alternative blocks, many alternative blocks of code for a satisfaction of a given condition, we will then use switch. This if, else, and else if condition is a part of single if else statement, and the switch is a different kind of statement. We will take a look at what are these statements and how we can use them in our programming. Okay, now let's see how we can use this if statement to do something useful in JavaScript. First, I'm opening this document with Notepad, and we have the basic structure here. Let's put a paragraph. Okay, now let's display good day if the time is before 6 p.m. But our JavaScript function returns the time in 24-hour format. So let's keep it in that format, okay, 18, right? Here, we will create another paragraph with the ID demo saying, good evening. Right. Now, if we save it and open it up, it shows good evening. But we can see the time is 3 p.m. So, how can we get the date of the local computer? I think you remember last time we did it. For example, we can say var date time equals new date. And then we have another method inside this object, date object. It says get hours. What we want to do is the time of the day. This date time variable is less than 18. we want to change the text of this demo paragraph, the paragraph with the ID demo. How do we do that? We have to use if statement here. If the time is less than 18, then we put the curly brackets. Then we can do the task. We can put the code block that we want to execute if this conditions becomes true inside within these curly braces or these curly brackets. I think you remember how can you do that. Document get element by ID demo in a HTML equals good day. Remember, we had to put a semicolon at the end of the statement. Right. Now let's save this one. And refresh. Right. Now it says good day. Now let's see how can we give another greeting. If the time is more than 18, we can say else. Right. In this else section, or we can say else segment, we can say document element by ID good evening. But because the time is now 3, it will still say good day because it's before 18 or 3 p.m. Right. But in programming, it is a good practice to assign these kind of variable, these kind of strings to a variable first, and then change the document in the final statement. For an example, here, create a variable called greeting and keep it empty. When the daytime, the time of the day is less than 18, we assign the good day string to this greeting variable. Whenever it is not satisfying this condition, we would assign the greeting variable good evening. And finally, here, we can assign the variable. Right. So how can we separate this time into three sections? One for the morning, one for the day, and one for the evening. Let's change these conditions. First, make the morning section. If the time is less than 10, that is 10 a.m., the greeting would be good morning. Right. Now here, if it is more than or equals to 10, but less than 20, we want to say good day. How can we do that? We can do that by adding another if statement here. Else if the time is less than 20, that would be good day. Finally, if none of these statements were true, we can create the block for the default case, that is good evening. Right. Let's try that out. It says good day. Let's change the time and see. I'm changing my system's time into the morning. Maybe 8 a.m. Now let's try that out. I'm opening the file in my browser. It says good morning because it's 8:22 a.m. now. Let's change it to a time, maybe to 11 a.m. Right, 11:22 a.m. Okay. Let's run it again. Right, good day. Now finally, let's change the time to maybe 9 p.m. It says good evening. By using these JavaScript methods or conditional statements, we can greet the customer or customize the experience of the user who's visiting the website or the web page and make it more dynamic and appealing one. Now you see, this if statement has an if here, an else if here, and an else here. Imagine a case that we have a if statement and also only a one else statement, if and else. In that case, we don't have to write all of these blocks. In JavaScript, there's a technique called ternary operator. Let's create another file. And here we have basic structure. And here we have paragraph called you are, and then we have another paragraph with empty content. Let's define a variable called age. Right, 24. And define another variable called result. And keep it empty. Now, what we want to do here is if the age is less than 20, we want to show you are a child. But the age is more than 20, we will show you are an adult. So with basic, with the if statement that we have learned before, we can do it by creating an if statement, if age is less than 20, right? Result equals a child. Else means if the age is more than or equals to 20, then the result would be an adult. And here we can update the paragraph document, get element by ID, demo in HTML equals result. You are an adult. But if we change this to 14, or let's say 5, You are a child. But if we have this kind of a statement, we don't have to write all of these blocks. The ternary operator allows us to do this in a very simple way. What we have to do is first mention our variable that we want to assign that value into, and then put a bracket and give the condition age less than 20, and then put a question mark and mention what value should the result get if age is less than 20. It should be a child. Then we put a colon and mention what value should the result variable get if this age is less than 20 condition is not met. In that case, it is an adult. And put semicolon. Let's delete this code block. Right. Now it is very simple, only one line and very clear. If age is less than 20, this string gets assigned to this variable, and then if age is more than or equal to 20, then an adult string will be assigned to this result. So our age is 5 now, a child, and if we put maybe 45, the result becomes an adult. Okay, now we know how to use conditions in JavaScript. In our previous example, we used this age of a person or the time of the date to determine a greeting. If you have noticed, in this if statement, we compared the value of the, for an example, in the case of the age, we compared the age whether it is less than 20. If you are checking only one value of a single variable in if-else-if statements, alternative we can use the switch statement, and it is a better option. But whenever we have comparisons, like if something is more than this value or something is less than this value, then we have to go with if-else-if statements. But if we only want to compare one integer value or a string, then we can switch to switch statement. One other useful fact about switch is it is very useful when multiple decisions can be made depending on the value of the expression. But in order to use the switch statement, the expression must evaluate to a constant integer or a convertible integers. So how this switch case statements work? Okay, let's do a small exercise with this switch statement. I'm opening up with the notepad. And we have the basic structure here. So here we have a paragraph with a text, today is a, and we have another due tag with the ID day name and a closing paragraph. In JavaScript, we can get the day of the week by using the date function that we have used before. I'm defining a variable called day. and I'm creating a new date object. And then I'm using the method get day. In this case, if it is a Sunday, it will return 0. If it is a Monday, it returns 1. Like that, it returns 0 through 6, representing the 7 days of the week. So let's put a switch statement, switch day and curly brackets. Right. The first case is case 0. And you can use curly brackets here and put a break, or else you can use even without the curly brackets here. But my personal practice is to use the curly brackets here. So I'm using it here. And here I'm defining another variable called day text. It is an empty one by default. So whenever the case of the day is 0, when it's matching, when the day is matching to 0, I'm assigning the day text to Sunday. And we put the break here. And what about case 1? Let's assign day text equals Monday. Similarly, case 2, Tuesday, some spaces there, case 3, Wednesday, case 4, Thursday, case 5, Friday, and finally, case 6 is Saturday. Right. So in this case, I'm not going to put a default case. But can you think of using default case in this example? First, we will use this code here and update our div tag with the ID day name. Here, document.getElementById. Now it is day name dot inner HTML equals day text. Now save this one and run it. Today is a Tuesday. Because today is a Tuesday. Now let's change the date. Maybe let's change the date to Sunday. So we close this one and open it again. Today is a Sunday. When I actually refresh after changing the date here, if I change the date here and refresh this one, it doesn't seem to work. The reason I think is the browser actually gets the date when we open it up. So whenever we close the browser and reopen it, it shows the correct date matching to the system's date and time. So how can we use the default statement intentionally here? Now this day is returning from 0 to 6. If we put a default, here and save, let's change the date to a Saturday. It shows Saturday because the 6th does not match with any of these cases, not with 0, not with 1, not with 2, 3, 4, 5, then the default case, we assign the variable, the value Saturday. So now let's take a look. What are the scenarios that we might want to avoid the breaks in this switch statement? I'm opening this file here. And this contains the same example that we have used before. That is, it returns Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, depending on the day number returning from this date and getDay method. GetDay method in this date object. So we all love weekends. Let's do something fun. Let's imagine we want to see how far we are from the weekend. Oh, are we in the weekend? I'm going to remove these cases here. Okay, now we have a clean switch statement. Now, in Thursday and Friday, we are so happy because weekend is coming. So how can we print the weekend is coming in both Thursday and Friday? Our first case is Thursday, that is number 4. And without the break keyword, we will mention case 5. Right? Now we mentioned the break here. And even here, we can say attention. And then message, right? Here, I'm renaming this variable to message. Right. Whenever it is case 4 or 5, that means Thursday or Friday, I want to set the message variable to soon it is weekend. Okay. So in Saturday and Sunday, that means 6 and 0. We set the message to we are in the weekend or it is the weekend. So what about the other days? What do you think? Do we want to mention case 1, 2, 3? Or do we mention Do we use the default statement here? I think it's better to use the default because that's more clean. Let's put the default keyword here. message equals looking forward to the weekend. It's always a positive note. Okay, now here we set the message due tag, the due tag with the ID message with our message. Right. Now here today is a Saturday, right? So we run it. Attention, it is the weekend. Now let's change this to Thursday. Soon it is weekend. Now let's change this to a Tuesday. Right, looking forward to the weekend. I think that's really fun, isn't it? Now let's take a look at how we can get an input from the user and then use it in a conditional statement. Let's open this file up. And here we have a paragraph with greetings and a placeholder for a name. In this case, I'm using a span HTML tag with a, you know, closing paragraph. And then we have a script pod block. Now here, so how we can get an input from the user? To accomplish this task, we can use the inbuilt JavaScript function prompt, and then we can enter the message to be shown to the user, such as please enter your name, and then we can put a default text if you want. Let's say Garmin, right. Now, in this case, we will just update the span tag with the result. Document get element by ID, name, HTML equals name. Let's try that out. All right. So default text came here. Let's put summer. Greetings, summer. So this text is dynamically assigned into this tag. If we take a look at the tag by using this inspect method here, we can see this name, the span tag with ID name, is populated with summer. If we run it again, we put Garmini, it shows Garmini. Okay, let's do something mathematical. Let's change this prompt to please enter your age. Let's not put a default value there. And then we assign that value into age variable. And we will change the text to greetings. You will be new age next year. So what we want to accomplish here is to add one into the age and then display in the placeholder. This a new age placeholder, right? So let's try that out. So we have age there. What I'm doing is I will add one to the age. Let's see what would be the outcome. Here also we need to update the ID, new age in HTML, and here edge. Right. Now first we take the edge and then we add one to the edge and then we update the placeholder with the ID new edge with the edge, the new edge, right? Edge of the next year. So we'll save it and see if it's working. Okay, enter your age. Okay, I'll say 55. Oh, what happened here? It concatenated the age and one. So this is not what we want. The reason is whenever we get a text from this input, it automatically assumes this is a string. So whatever the value we put here, even it is a number like 50 or 35, it treats this as a string. So we have already learned whenever JavaScript thinks this is a string, it concatenates the numbers or any other thing to the same string without treating them as integers or numbers. So how can we really add one to the number that we are passing? We can do this by using some inbuilt functions of JavaScript. What we have to do is we have to assign age is number age. Now let's try that out. Save. Right. 40. Right. Now it's treating it as a number and adding one to the number that we have entered. So there are different ways that we can pass, that we can convert a string to a number. This is a one way to do this. And also we can use the pass int method or function. Let's try that out. 10. Okay, 11, that's good. But what if we enter a decimal number? 15.2. It treated it as an integer and removed all the decimals. That is the quality of this function. Because int represent integers, in computer science, integers do not hold decimal values. Whatever the number we enter here, it will remove the decimal values and only consider the non-decimal part of the number. So what if we want to really include the decimals? We have another function called parsefloat. Let's try that out. 25.6. Now it is adding 1 into 25.6, that is 26.6. So that's how we get an input from the user and then pass it to as per the requirement. So there is another way users can input something into our HTML page. When we learned about forms, we talked about inputs. Let's take an input into this page. Okay. I'm adding a label here. Your age. And also, I'm adding an input here. Let's mention the type as text. Let's put a placeholder. Default value empty. And also, let's include a button. Right. And also add some breaks here. Ratings, you will be new age next year. We will use the same example here, but with an input. If you remember, we can invoke functions in HTML elements. For example, on click, update age. In this case, I have an onClick attribute and I'm calling a function. But first, we need to define this function here. Let's delete this previous example and create a function called updateAge. Right. So, what we want to accomplish here is whenever this user clicks on this button, we want to get the number in this input. And then add the value of 1 and then update this placeholder. In JavaScript, we can actually get the element, this DOM elements to variables. Let's define a variable called x. What we can do is we can get the element by x equals document element by ID. So we don't have an ID there. Let's create an ID. Current age. So current age. After assigning this DOM element into a variable, we can access its properties. For an example, x.value would be the value of this input. So what I'm doing here, first I'll pass this value into a number and then update this placeholder after adding 1. We can do that by in a HTML. X. So whenever the user clicks on this button, this function should be invoked. And inside that, we take the current value of this input and then pass it to a number and then add 1 and then update this placeholder. Save it. Right. Let's put 10 and see. Now it says not a number. In JavaScript, whenever the variable that we are referring is not a number, it shows not a number. Did you spot the problem here? We have assigned the object into the x. But if you want to get the value, we want to either assign the value to the same variable or to a different variable. In this case, let's assign that to the same variable. You can say x equals x dot value. Now if we enter 10, it's 11. But we don't have to do this in a different line. We can get the value in the same line, like this. Even now, it should work. In the previous lesson, we looked into the different data types JavaScript can manage. Now we will take a look how we can convert from one data type to another. We have experienced something similar before when we worked with numbers and strings. But here, in that case, the JavaScript interpreter automatically converted the strings and numbers by predefined logics. But in JavaScript, even we can instruct the JavaScript interpreter what to do with data types. We can explicitly convert string to numbers, numbers to strings, so on. Let's open this file in a different text editor now. Actually, up to now, we have been using the Notepad for our all text editing. But Notepad is a very primitive text editor, and you might not want to use it for your web development. I have used that so far to let you know that even from a Notepad, we can do all the things that we want in website development. But today, I'm using a different text editor. This text editor is called Sublime. And not only that, there are lots of other text editors which are supporting HTML development, making your life very easy. Instantly, you can see here, the HTML tags are color coded and they are in a different color. The script type, different color, strings, text, different color. So when we have the syntax colored like this, it's very easy to do the development. Otherwise, it's not that easy to identify different sections of the code and different data types, different syntax. And I advise you to try different text editors and use the best work for you. One of the popular text editor would be the Visual Studio Code. And there are some open source variations like Genie and even Sublime and PHP Storm. These are kind of text editors that we can use. So in this case, let's try to see different data types. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm creating a paragraph here and let's give ID, data types. If you have noticed in this editor, whenever we have opened a paragraph and whenever we try to close, it automatically identifies, okay, we have opened a paragraph, now we need to close it. So your effort need to complete the syntax reduces. So that is a great benefit of using this kind of rich editors. So we have a paragraph here, and let's update the contents like this: document, get element by ID, data types dot inner HTML equals, let's say, type of Garmini. Put a plus mark, and then type of 3.14 plus break. Are you wondering why we put this break tags here? Because we are going to update this text inside this paragraph, and we want to come the data types one after another, not in a single line. So we have to add these breaks in order to accomplish that functionality. So next we have a type of not a number, so I'll copy this part here, type of an array object, maybe 1, 2, 3, 4. And another object, and let's try date object, and again, try another function, type of a new function. And also, let's see, my car. If you have noticed, we have not defined this my car variable yet, and see what will happen. And finally, a null. And then we have to put a semicolon. To define a function, we need to put curly braces here. Let's save it. Yes. Now let's open up here. First one is Garmini, and it is a string. Second one is a number. Third one is also a number in JavaScript. And then we have an object, a function. And because we have not defined this so far, this variable Micah is not defined, so undefined. The type is undefined. And finally, we have a null object. So how can we convert one data type into another? Now let's define this variable x equals 123. And then let's update this paragraph. Document, get element by ID, data types, HTML equals string x. So we are passing our variable x to this string function plus breaks. And then we can directly put the number, and then we'll do the same thing, but we will add the 123 inside the parentheses and then semicolon. Data types in HTML. Let's save it and see. In all of the scenarios, the outcome is the same, 123. So, is it possible to convert Boolean values? For an example, let's take X as true. Can we? Can we convert Boolean into a string? Let's try that out. Yes, it converted into a string. You may wonder, what if we don't convert and then concatenate? Let's try that out. It automatically converts. But here we can explicitly convert it. One other way of conversion is by using toString method. For an example, x to string. What about if we put the Boolean value itself here, false to string? Right. Now, what happens if we remove the string here? Still, it converts to a string. What if we remove the toString part? If we keep only the false here, again it converts. Right? So let's create a date. Right? So what if we put the date here? It converts to a string and displays here. Right? So, what if we put a new statement, new date? Again, it converts and displays here. One other way, we can do this conversion is to use the string function. Let's remove that one. Save. Right. And also, similar to what we did for the Booleans, we can also use toString method. Save. If you remember, in the previous lesson, we did a small exercise by adding a string to a number. So what happens if we add 5 to null? If you remember, the null returns an object. But here it converted into a number and then converted to a string to show us here. this null is converted to a zero and added to 5 and 10. So what if we add the string 5 to null? Can you guess what would be the answer? Now, because 5 is a string, this null has converted to a string and then concatenated with the 5. Even though we did not explicitly convert the null into a string, the JavaScript actually understood, okay, this is a string, then this has to be a string. And let's convert this to a string. What will happen if we add 5 to 2? I think you know the answer. It's 5 concatenated to 2. What happens if we deduct 2 from string 5? Now the JavaScript interpreter understands, okay, in order to deduct, this has to be a number. Then the interpreter automatically converts this to a number and then deducts. How about multiplication? Right. It multiplied 5 by 2. Right. Now JavaScript automatically calls this to string function whenever applicable. What happens if we multiply the string 5 into string 2? Nothing. Because whenever we explicitly mention, okay, this is a string, the interpreter gets confused. So how can we do this? How can we multiply two strings? Then it gives no answer. How about deducting string 2 from string 5? Nothing. How about we deduct string 2 from number 5? Still now, because we have explicitly said, okay, this is a string, not a number. So interpreter has no idea how to deduct a string from a number. How about objects? If we have a variable, whenever JavaScript wants to put a value of the variable, it automatically calls this function, as we have described before. So at the moment, this myvar has no string value. Nothing. But here, it converts it to an empty string and displays the value. But what if this is an object like name, Garmin, age, 45? What will happen now? Now this is an object and JavaScript calls the two string of this object and then it shows this is an object. Actually, we can define a two string method in an object and change what will appear whenever we want to show the object. just define a function. You see, whenever we define this toString as a function, a method, then we can say, okay, what should be this object's toString should be. In this case, we add this string, some person called, with the name attribute of the object. In this case, some person called Darwin. If we change the name attribute like this, myUR, name equals Pereira, what would be the output when we assign this variable to this div tag, this element? Now, it's some person called Pereira. How cool is that? Let's try something out. Let's put another object. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's an array. Let's remove this one. Now it converts to a sequence of numbers. So when this array's implementation has specified a toString method to display these numbers whenever we want to show the array. How about this new date? This date object also has a toString method showing this kind of a value. Now let's take a look at functions and their parameters. Right. Let's define a sample function. I call it function name. First, we have to define it's a function. Function name, and then we have to specify the parameters. Parameter 1, parameter 2, so on. And then we shall have a body of the function between two curly brackets. In JavaScript, it does not check the type of the parameters when we pass. These are the function parameters. And whenever we pass a variable, let's say we somewhere in the code, we pass function name apple to something like this, then this parameter one gets assigned with the string apple, and parameter two gets assigned with the number two. But in another section of the code, we can actually call the same function with different value, maybe 45, something like this. So in this case, this param 1 gets assigned with 45 and param 2 gets assigned with the string. So there's no restriction when passing the values into this function as parameters. But in some other programming languages, that might not be the case. But in JavaScript, it's very flexible. So the JavaScript function definition do not specify the data types, as we have mentioned before. And JavaScript functions do not make perform any type checking. And also, functions do not check number of parameters received by the function. If it is not passed, then it would be an undefined one. Okay, now let's create an HTML element here, maybe paragraph. Now here, I create a variable called value and I call this function. Let's rename this function as concatenate. What it does is concatenate two parameters and return it. So return param1 plus a dash plus param2. So in this case, value is concatenate apple mango. And then function return HTML value. So if you run it, it's just apple mango. What if we do not pass the second parameter? Let's save and see. It says apple and undefined. Because now this parameter we did not pass. So the JavaScript assumed this is an undefined parameter and converted this undefined into a string and concatenated here. So it is always a best practice to handle these kind of scenarios. For an example, we can check if param2 equals undefined, then we can actually assign param2 equals unknown fruit. Save it. Now it's handling the scenario and returning unknown fruit instead of an undefined text. So let's create another function called addition, or simply add number one and number two. Return n1 plus n2. Let's add 10 plus 6. Save it. The summation is 16. What if we don't pass the second parameter? Not a number, because now we are not passing the second value, second parameter. So it is an undefined one, right? Then whenever it's undefined, we can't add it. So what we have to do is put a default value in it if it is not passed. For example, if n2 equals undefined, then n2 equals 0. Now it's 10. But what if we don't add any parameter? Again, it's a not number, because now even n1 is undefined and we can't add 0 to undefined. In that case, anyway, we have to define a default for the environment as well. Like this. Save it. Right, save it. Let's delete these two functions. In JavaScript, with functions, there is a special implementation. Whenever you have a function, let's call it list details. And in this case, I will not specify any parameter in the function, but let's call this function with some parameters anyway. So I'm creating another variable called x, and I'm invoking this function with some variables, 1, 1, 2, 3, 500, 115, 44, and 88, right? I'm invoking the function with these variables, and in JavaScript, we can access these parameters by using a special variable called arguments. For an example, let's create a variable called I and put a value 2, right? And create another variable called A and assign the argument with the index of 2 here. Arguments 2, right? So create another variable called items and this holds the number of arguments. Use this dot length attribute to get the number of elements, items in this object or this array. And even we can create something like if arguments 0 equals 0, we can return A. Else, return items. Right. So what would happen if we call this function like this and put the value here into this function return element? Let's try that out. It says 6. How many elements in this in our arguments variable here? How many parameters? It is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what we are telling here is, okay, if the first element, first argument is 0, then return the third element. But any other case, if the first element is not 0, then return number of items, number of parameters. So let's change this to 0 and see. It returns 500. 0, 1, 2. The number, parameter number with the second index is 500. And in this case, we are returning 500. So this is how we can use the arguments built-in variable. Actually, it is an object automatically holding all the parameters passed into the function. Okay. Now we are getting into something exciting, right? Now I am returning edge. So it will maybe edge plus 1. So let's change the function to plus one, and then we call the same function here, right? So whenever we pass a value into this function, we return one added to the value that we pass. For example, if we pass 10, this should return 11. Let's see. It says 11. Okay. Now I'll create another element HTML tag called original. I will update this other paragraph that we have. It has the ID original. And we will set the value age. So originally it was 10 and we pass the value into the function and it returns 11, nothing special. Let's see what is the output. Before that, I will create a break here, but not need it anyway. So we have 11 and we have 10. So function returns 11, original value is 10. So you may wonder what will happen if we increase the value of this variable, age equals age plus 1, and then return the age. What would be your guess? There can be two scenarios. Because we are passing a value here, either it should update whenever we add one to the same parameter, either it should update this original value or not. So in this case, it will not update the original value because in JavaScript, these parameters are passed by value. Value means, now, in the memory, this variable has a value of 10, right? So number 10 get passed into the function, and then inside and one get added to the variable, and then we return the variable created within the function, and that is 11. That's totally fine. But what will happen if we pass an object into the function as a parameter? Okay, now I am creating a new object called let's create an object of person and age equals 50, right? And I'm passing this person object into this function and rename this as person. And inside, what I'm doing is person.age equals person.age plus 1, and then return. Maybe let's return the person's age. We are not even returning the object. We are just returning the age of this person, this attribute of this object. Okay. Now here, what we are doing here is, okay, we created the person and we pass this person to the plus one function, and then got the value, and we are updating the value here, and we put the person's age, this variable's, this object's age attribute here. But avoid confusion, I will rename this variable as human. So it's a different name inside. So we are passing this person here, and inside the function, it treats as a human, and age gets incremented by one and returns the human's age. So can you imagine what would be the value for x and what would be the value for person's age? If you guessed x is 16, you are correct. If you guessed person's age as 15, you are not correct. Why? Let's try that out. Now it is 16. How come? We learn in JavaScript, we are passing the value of a variable. In the previous example, when we passed the number 10 as the age, that was a numerical variable and it passed the number 10. But whenever JavaScript maintains an object, it holds the address of the object as a value. Now, this is the area that if you are interested, you search for pointers. We have pointers in the memory that we points to a particular section of the memory, and then we can create a different object there. So in this case also, this person variable only keeps the pointer to this object. And whenever we pass the person into this function, this pointer's value, actually this address get passed, and then these operations are done in the original object. That's why whenever we added one into this human.age, it automatically updated this object as well. I think that's clear. That's a really interesting area of programming. Right. Okay. Let's remove this. Sections. Now we are getting into really exciting things. In programming, there is a concept called recursion. In JavaScript also, we can use this recursion to achieve particular tasks or particular outcomes. I will explain this by an example. Okay. Function add all and we pass x, right? Whenever x equals 1, we return 1. Else, we return x plus we call the same function and all x minus 1. So this is the function. And what do you think would be the output if we create a variable called x and call this function and all with number 1? And let's update the DOM element, this paragraph with the value. Document. X. So if when we pass 1, let's see, now X is actually 1, then return 1. It should return 1, let's see. Right, it's 1. But what happens if we pass number 2? Let's save it. It returns 3. How did that happen? Okay. What happens here is, whenever we call this function here, it first checks whether it's 2. But it is not 2. Then it goes to this else section. And then what it does is it returns 2 plus add all, 2 minus 1 is 1. This one here. But we knew, but we saw at all 1 is 1. So it returns 1 and then 2 plus 1 is 3. So what happens is we pass 3. Can you guess the answer? Let's go through. Okay, first it will come here. Right? It is not 1. So it will go to this section. First, it will try to add 3 plus add all 2. Right? Then for this one, it will come again to the same function with the parameter 2. So it will actually come to this section because it is not 1. And here, 2 plus add all, 2 minus 1 is 1. Let's comment this out like this. And again, it will call the same function with the parameter 1, and it will return, because it is 1, it will return 1. So this will return 1. And this will return 3. And then finally, it will return 3 plus 3, 6. Let's find that out. Yes. So recursive functions are very important and exciting sections of programming. So I really would like you to go here. I mean, go there out and see what are the applications of a recursive functions. Lots of problems can be solved easily with recursive functions when we understand the problem correctly. So as an exercise, you may want to write a new JavaScript to obtain an integer from an input box and calculate the summation of all positive integers up to the given number. For an example, let's say we input 10. Then the output of the function should contain 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. There are lots of ways to do this, even without recursive functions, but try to accomplish this task using recursive functions. You will learn lots of things, lots of interesting things. All the best.